Welcome back to another lecture of Dental Pathshala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy. And this video is a continuation of the anatomy series. Today we'll be talking about the triangles of the neck. Before we get started, make sure to subscribe to the channel and hit on the bell icon so that you don't miss any of our exciting videos. So let's get started. We have the base of the mandible over here. Then we also have hyoid bone somewhere here. So this is our hyoid bone. And then we have the base of the mandible. The sternum, clavicle. So guys, we have sternocleidomastoid muscle. As the name suggests, sternocleidomastoid. So sterno means from the origin, from the sternum. Cleido means origin, also from the clavicle, and inserted into the mastoid bone. So we have sternocleidomastoid muscle, which originates from the sternum and the clavicle and get inserted into the mastoid bone. So this is our sternocleidomastoid. So this sternocleidomastoid muscle marks the boundary between the anterior triangle and the posterior triangle of the neck. So this triangle is our anterior triangle of the neck, and posterior to the sternocleidomastoid we have the posterior triangle of the neck. So this is our posterior triangle of the neck. And back we have the trapezius muscle. So we have the trapezius muscle. So guys, these are the two triangles of the neck, the anterior triangle of the neck as well as the posterior triangle of the neck. And anteriorly we can also see the anterior and posterior belly of digastric. So we have digastric muscle. Anterior belly originates from the base of the mandible inserted into the hyoid bone. We also have posterior belly of digastric originating from the hyoid bone and insert into the mandible. So this is our anterior and posterior belly of digastric. So this is the anterior belly of digastric, which is located anteriorly, which originates from the first pharyngeal arch. And posterior belly of digastric we have studied in the second pharyngeal arch. So anterior belly of digastric is supplied by the mandibular branch of the trigeminal nerve, while the posterior belly is supplied by the facial nerve. We also have omohyoid muscle. So originating from the clavicle and inserting into the hyoid bone, as the name suggests. So this is the omohyoid muscle. So guys, omohyoid muscle. The one which is situated anteriorly is the anterior belly of omohyoid. The one which is situated posteriorly is the posterior belly of omohyoid. And if you remember, we have studied the sternocleidomastoid muscle. It lines the boundary between the anterior triangle and the posterior triangle of the neck. So this is our sternocleidomastoid muscle, which divides the neck into anterior triangle and the posterior triangle. So this is our sternocleidomastoid. Now in the anterior triangle, we have some small triangles. We have four small triangles. The triangle which is situated inside the digastric muscle is our digastric triangle. So this is our digastric triangle. Then the triangle which is situated, the anterior triangle which is situated below the digastric triangle, we have is the carotid triangle. Why the name carotid triangle is that? we see the bifurcation of the common carotid artery into internal carotid and external carotid in this particular region. That is why we call this the carotid triangle. Below this we have the muscular triangle. Why the muscular triangle? Because we see the strap muscles, the neck muscles in this particular area. The posterior triangle is also subdivided into two triangles, as we can appreciate. The one which is the largest one, so this triangle which is the largest one, is our occipital triangle, which is towards the occipital bone. The one which is close to the clavicle or the scapula, so this is our subclavian triangle, because we see the subclavian artery in this triangle. So we have studied the anterior triangle, posterior triangle. They are bounded by the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So this is our sternocleidomastoid muscle. Then in the anterior triangle, we have studied the triangle which is lined by the anterior and posterior belly of digastric is our digastric triangle. Below this we have is the carotid triangle, wherein we are going to see the carotid artery, common carotid artery, bifurcating into the internal carotid and the external carotid artery. Below this we have the muscular triangle. Also in the anterior triangle of the neck, we also see the submental triangle, which we cannot appreciate in this particular diagram over here, but we'll be seeing in the three-dimensional structure. So somewhere here we will find this submental triangle, which is below the midline. This is basically a midline triangle below the mentum of the mandible. So anterior belly of digastric on the both side, and base is the hyoid bone. So this triangle is going to be our submental triangle. In the posterior triangles, we have studied two triangles. The larger one we have is the occipital triangle. The smaller one is the subclavian triangle. So let's see in a three-dimensional diagram. So guys, if you can appreciate, this is the base of the mandible, and you can see the anterior belly and posterior belly of digastric. So this is the anterior belly of digastric, then we have the posterior belly of digastric. Below this we have the hyoid bone, and above we have the base of the mandible, as you can see. And the anterior belly of digastric originating from the base of the mandible, inserting into the hyoid bone and basically inserting into this tendinous ligament. So this ligament, intermediate tendon of the digastric muscle. So wherein we see the posterior and anterior belly of digastric. And you can see this digastric triangle also. So guys, if you can see, this is the anterior belly of digastric. Then we have the posterior belly of digastric inserting into the mastoid process. And you can see this is the hyoid bone, which is a U-shaped bone. Also we can see the base of the mandible. And in between this, we have a triangle over here. This triangle is known as the digastric triangle. So this is a digastric triangle, which is lined by the digastric muscles. And guys, if you can see this digastric triangle, the anterior belly of digastric, it is surrounded by the anterior belly of digastric, which originates from the mandible, insert into the tendon of the digastric muscle, and which is inserting into the hyoid bone. The posterior belly attaches to the hyoid bone and the mastoid bone, and the base is the mandible. The floor, if you can see, is the mylohyoid muscle. So if you can appreciate, this muscle is the mylohyoid muscle, which forms the base, or we can say the floor. Basically it forms the floor of the digastric triangle. I'm going to show you in a three-dimensional structure also. So it forms the floor of the digastric triangle. Also you will find one more muscle. When you will look from above, you will find one more muscle, which is the hyoglossus muscle, which is also situated on the floor of the digastric triangle. So which is supplied by the 12th cranial nerve. So remember this, that the floor of the digastric triangle is by two muscles, the mylohyoid muscle and the hyoglossus muscle. Since hyoglossus is a muscle of the tongue, as you can see in the name itself, glossus means tongue, hyo means hyoid bone. So hyoglossus is a muscle which originates from the hyoid bone, inserts into the tongue. Since it is inserting into the tongue, it's a depressor of a tongue. That is why it is supplied by the 12th cranial nerve, which is the hypoglossal nerve. So this hypoglossal nerve, it comes from the hypoglossal canal, which is close to the foramen magnum, which we have studied in the foramens of the cranial cavity. If you haven't watched the video, I recommend you to watch that video. So we have studied that in the posterior cranial fossa, we have studied the foramens, which are the jugular foramen. And then we also have, first of all, we have studied the internal auditory meatus, which gives the 7th and 8th nerve, then jugular foramen, the 9th, 10th and 11th nerve. And then we have studied the hypoglossal canal, which gives off the 12th cranial nerve, and then the foramen magnum, the big foramen, right? So hypoglossal canal, if you remember, the 12th cranial nerve, the hypoglossal nerve, enters the carotid triangle first, and then it goes to the digastric triangle, and then supplies the hyoglossus muscle. This hyoglossus muscle, which is situated in the floor of the digastric triangle. So we have 12th cranial nerve coming from the carotid triangle, goes into the digastric triangle and supplies the hyoglossus. So if you can see over here, we have the posterior belly of digastric. And if you can see over here, we have the hyoglossus muscle also. This is the genioglossus, but we also have the hyoglossus muscle. So if you can see, we have the myelohyoid muscle, which is situated at the floor. So if you can see, it is situated at the floor. So if you see the digastric triangle, the muscle which is situated at the floor of the digastric triangle is the myelohyoid muscle. So now you can remember it. And then we have the digastric triangle over here. We also have submental triangle. Now you can appreciate over here. This is the digastric triangle, guys. Between the anterior and posterior belly of digastric. You can also see the submental triangle this time over here. So this is our submental triangle, which is between this anterior belly of digastric. So it is sandwiched between the anterior. This is the anterior belly of digastric. Then we have the posterior belly of digastric. And the submental triangle is between the anterior belly of digastric. So base is the hyoid bone, as you can see, base is the hyoid bone and apex is the base of the mandible. So this is the submental triangle. It is situated between the anterior belly of digastric on both the sides and base is the hyoid bone. So tip of tongue drains into the submental lymph node, and this submental lymph node drains into the deep cervical lymph node or the submandibular lymph node. So basically the submental triangle, it is situated in the midline. So if you can see the midline, it is situated in the midline of the neck under the mentum of the mandible. So now let's see. We have the sternocleidomastoid muscle originating from the sternum and the clavicle and inserting into the mastoid bone. So this is the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So as you can see, the sternum bone, the clavicle bone, and then originating from the sternum and the clavicle and inserting into the mastoid bone. As you can see, the mastoid process, as you can appreciate the mastoid process of the occipital bone over here. So originating into the mastoid bone. So this is the sternocleidomastoid muscle, which marks the boundary line between the anterior triangle of the neck and the posterior triangle of the neck. So anterior and posterior triangle are divided by the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Now let's see the omohyoid muscle. So omohyoid muscle, if you can see, it's originating from the scapula and then inserting into the hyoid bone. So we have two belly of omohyoid. So guys, this one is the anterior belly of the omohyoid or superior belly. So this is the superior belly of the omohyoid, which is situated superiorly. Then we also have the inferior belly of the omohyoid. So this is the inferior belly of the omohyoid, which is inserting into the, which is the origin is from the scapula. So this is the inferior belly of Homo hyoid. And we have the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So let's draw the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So that is going to be like this, right? So we have the anterior triangle over here and the posterior triangle over here. So this is the anterior triangle. Let's draw it from the other color, guys. So we have the sternocleidomastoid, which is going to be like this, right? So this is the sternocleidomastoid muscle, which marks the boundary between the anterior belly, anterior triangle of the neck and the posterior triangle. So here we will have the anterior triangle of the neck, and posterior to the sternocleidomastoid is going to be our posterior triangle of the neck. And the anterior triangle is also subdivided into the digastric triangle. Then we have the carotid triangle, muscular triangle and the submental triangle. And the posterior triangle is also divided into the occipital triangle and the subclavian triangle, wherein we are going to see the subclavian artery. So this is our subclavian triangle. So if you can see the Homo hyoid, we have this Homo hyoid muscle from the scapula to the hyoid bone, originating from the scapula, inserting into the hyoid bone. So let's see the hyoid bone, which is the U-shaped bone. So this is the hyoid bone, guys. Hyoid bone. As you can see, this is the Homo hyoid muscle. We have got two bellies, the inferior belly and the superior belly of Homo hyoid. So the one which is cut, you can see the inferior belly of the Homo hyoid over here. The other side, we have the inferior belly. This is the inferior belly of Homo hyoid. And the superior one is which is inserting into the hyoid bone. Now let's see the subclavian triangle, which is close to the, which is basically a posterior triangle. So that's the Homo hyoid. Now see the Homo hyoid. Now let's see the supraclavicular or the subclavian triangle. If you remember, posterior triangle is subdivided into two triangles. The occipital triangle, which is the larger one. And below we have, close to the clavicle or the sternum, we have the supraclavicular triangle. So which is above the clavicle, or we can say the subclavian triangle, wherein we see the subclavian artery. So this subclavian triangle, we have three muscles. So let's see the muscle originating from the first rib. We have is the sclerus anterior muscle. So this muscle is the sclerus anterior muscle, which is a component of a subclavian triangle. So this is a sclerus anterior muscle. We have the middle and the posterior as well. So this is the sclerus middle, posterior and the sclerus anterior. So sclerus anterior muscle, we see that the subclavian artery, that is why we are talking about subclavian triangle. So the subclavian artery, it passes behind the sclerus anterior muscle. So if you know that arch of aorta give rise to the first division is the brachiocephalic trunk. From the brachiocephalic trunk, right side we have the subclavian artery and the common carotid artery. So common carotid artery bifurcates into the external carotid artery and continues as the internal carotid artery. So this bifurcation is present in the carotid triangle. So guys, this bifurcation of the common carotid artery is seen in the carotid triangle. That is why we call it the carotid triangle, because this carotid triangle has got internal jugular vein, the common carotid artery, especially the internal carotid artery, because the internal carotid artery is a continuation of the common carotid artery, and in between we see the vagus nerve also, and all three components are embedded in the carotid sheath. So carotid sheath is a component of the carotid triangle, and behind this we are going to see the sympathetic trunk. So if you can see the one over here in the white, which is posterior to this carotid sheath, is our sympathetic trunk. So this is the sympathetic trunk, and above this, yani that means anterior to this, is going to be our ansa cervicalis. So ansa cervicalis is present anterior to the carotid sheath, while on the other hand sympathetic trunk is present posterior to the carotid sheath. So behind the carotid sheath we will find this sympathetic trunk, and in front of the carotid sheath you will find the ansa cervicalis. So, and also we have studied the subclavian triangle. In the subclavian triangle, guys, we have this anterior sclerenous muscle which is going to divide the subclavian artery into three components. The first part of the subclavian artery, which is present proximally, the second part of the subclavian artery, which is deeper into this anterior sclerenous muscle, and the third part of the subclavian artery, which is distal to the subclavian artery. So let's have a look at again. We have the subclavian artery. So this is the sympathetic trunk, which is situated posterior to the carotid sheath. So it is behind the carotid sheath. So that is the sympathetic trunk. As you can see, the subclavian artery, it gives three parts. First part, second part, which is behind the sclerenous anterior muscle. So in the subclavian triangle, we see the sclerenous anterior muscle, and the sclerenous anterior muscle divides the subclavian artery into three parts. So this is our subclavian artery. It divides the subclavian artery into three parts. The first part, the second part, which is deep to the sclerenous anterior muscle. So the second part is of the subclavian artery is deep to this anterior sclerenous muscle, and we also have the third part. So first part, second part, and the third part. We have the distal part, the deep part, and the proximal part of the subclavian artery. And this is seen in the subclavian triangle. Say suppose this is the anterior belly of omohyoid, inferior belly of omohyoid. Then this is a content of the subclavian triangle. So in the subclavian triangle, we are going to see the subclavian artery. So the subclavian, you can say the subclavian triangle, or we can also say the supraclavicular, because it is above the clavicle. Supraclavicular triangle, which is a part of a posterior triangle of the neck. So it is a part of the posterior triangle of the neck. Posterior triangle of the neck, we have studied two triangles. One is the occipital triangle, which is the bigger one, which is towards the occipital bone. And another one is the subclavian, or we can say the supraclavicular. So if you can see, here we also have ansa cervicalis. So that is ansa cervicalis is going to be in front of the carotid sheath. And if you can see over here, we have this neck muscles. So we have the sternocleidomastoid, the trapezius. So this is the trapezius muscle. Then we have the sternocleidomastoid originating from the sternum and the clavicle inserting into the mastoid bone. So the other side also, sternocleidomastoid, you can see inserting into the mastoid bone. We also have the omohyoid muscle. So this is the sternum. We also have this is the clavicle. Then this is the sternocleidomastoid. Then we also have this omohyoid, which is passing beneath the sternocleidomastoid. So which subdivides the anterior triangle and the posterior triangle. You can see this is the omohyoid muscle. So guys, let's see the triangles. We have this anterior belly of digastric. Then we have the posterior belly of digastric. And in between we have the digastric triangle. So this is our digastric triangle. And the floor of the digastric triangle, you can appreciate this mylohyoid muscle, which is situated at the floor of the digastric triangle. Also in the floor of the digastric triangle, We see the hyoglossus muscle. So hyoglossus, since it is a muscle of the tongue, therefore it is supplied by the 12th cranial nerve. And we know that the 12th cranial nerve coming from the hypoglossal canal, and then it is going from the carotid triangle. So coming from the carotid triangle, coming from the hypoglossal canal, passing the carotid triangle, and then going into the digastric triangle. So this is going to be our 12th cranial nerve, the hypoglossal nerve, which is then supplying the hyoglossus muscle, the muscle of the tongue, because it has to supply the tongue, right? But it is crossing the carotid triangle. So up till now, we know that the content of carotid triangle is going to be the common carotid artery bifurcating into the internal and external carotid artery. Then we also have the internal jugular vein, and in between we have the vagus nerve, and all these three components are into the carotid sheath. And then front of the carotid sheath we have ansa cervicalis, behind the carotid sheath we have the sympathetic trunk. So these all are the content of the carotid triangle. And in the digastric triangle, we have studied that the digastric triangle is bounded by the anterior and posterior belly of digastric. In the base, we have the base of the mandible. And also in the floor, we have seen the mylohyoid muscle and also the hyoglossus muscle. We have also seen the 12th cranial nerve, which is coming from the carotid triangle, coming from the hypoglossal canal and entering into the digastric triangle. Therefore, it supplies the hyoglossus muscle. And in the carotid triangle, we have studied the common carotid artery bifurcating into two branches. And the common carotid artery is also followed by the internal jugular vein. Guys, always remember this, that in the carotid sheath, we are going to have the internal carotid artery, which is a continuation of the common carotid artery. So this is a common carotid artery which bifurcates into the external carotid artery and continues as the internal carotid artery. So in the carotid sheath, we have the internal carotid artery. Along with that, we have the internal jugular vein. So everything is internal in case of carotid. Always remember that internal jugular vein is a content of a carotid triangle, is a content of carotid sheath. While on the other hand, the external jugular vein is a content of the posterior triangle, which we are going to study in some time. So here we are also going to have the hyoid bone, guys. Hyoid bone is missing in here. So the content of the, and the carotid triangle is bounded by the superior belly of the omohyoid. If you can see, this is the superior belly of the omohyoid. Also the posterior belly of digastric. Above we have the posterior belly of digastric. And you can also see the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So the carotid sheath, it is a sheath which contains the internal jugular vein. Then it also contains the internal carotid artery, which lines medially to this internal jugular vein. And in between, we can see the vagus nerve, which is basically in between and behind this. So that is the 10th cranial nerve, the vagus nerve. So these are the content of the carotid sheath. We have the internal carotid artery. We also have the internal jugular vein. And we also have the 10th cranial nerve, which is in between and behind the vessels. And in front of the carotid sheath, you will find the ansa cervicalis in the anterior wall. And in the posterior, that means behind the carotid sheath, you will find the sympathetic chain. Here you can also appreciate the submental triangle. So guys, this is the submental triangle, which is surrounded by the anterior belly of digastric. So this is the anterior belly of digastric on the both sides, and the base is hyoid bone. So here is going to be the hyoid bone. Apex is the mental of the mandible. So this is the submental triangle. Here you can also see this digastric triangle. So this is the digastric triangle. We can also see the carotid triangle over here. So this is the carotid triangle. and the muscular triangle, which is going to be like this. So this is the muscular triangle, because we see the strap muscles in this triangle, therefore we call it the muscular triangle. So these all are the four anterior triangles of the neck. Submental triangle is the only unpaired triangle. So it is basically a single triangle. Rest you will find triangles on both the sides. So similarly, we have the muscular triangle here. We also have the muscular triangle here. We have the carotid triangle on the other side. We also have the digastric triangle of the another side. But we have only one submental triangle. Now you can see the posterior belly of digastric, the myeloid, which forms the floor of the digastric triangle, the posterior belly of digastric. We also have the omohyoid, which divides the muscular triangle and the carotid triangle. So the myelohyoid, you can also see the floor of the mouth, wherein you are going to see the floor of the digastric triangle. You will find the hyoglossus muscle and the myelohyoid. So as you can see, this myelohyoid forms the floor of the digastric triangle. So if you can see this myelohyoid muscle, see guys, hyoid bone is missing. So the space you can see, and if you can nicely see the triangle, this triangular space is our. So let me just show you once again. So here we can see the digastric triangle and the submental triangle. Also, you can also appreciate all the anterior triangles over here. You can see the carotid triangle, muscular triangle. So now that you can appreciate all the triangles. Now guys, you can see this is the sternocleidomastoid muscle, which is going to give the boundary to anterior triangle and the posterior triangle. So whatever is present anteriorly is going to be our anterior triangle. And the triangle which is present posteriorly is our posterior triangle. Now you can also see the anterior triangle and the posterior triangle is again subdivided into more triangles by the omohyoid muscle. So this is the omohyoid, inferior belly of omohyoid. Then we have the superior belly of omohyoid. So this superior belly of omohyoid divides the carotid triangle and the muscular triangle, while this inferior belly of omohyoids divide into this is the occipital triangle, which is towards the occipital bone. We also have the supraclavicular triangle above the clavicle bone. So this is the clavicle bone. Above the clavicle bone, we can see this supraclavicular triangle, and also you can also say the subclavian triangle, because we have seen the subclavian artery passing from this triangle. So this is going to be our occipital triangle. So guys, this is our occipital triangle, which is a posterior triangle. Anteriorly you can see this subclavian triangle. And we know that the 11th cranial nerve supplies the sternocleidomastoid muscle and the trapezius muscle. So the spinal accessory nerves goes from the sternocleidomastoid and it supplies the trapezius muscle. So this is our 11th cranial nerve, the spinal accessory nerve, which supplies the sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius. So this is going to be our spinal accessory nerve. Since it is supplying the sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius muscle, so it is a component of the occipital triangle. And guys, remember this, that suppose if there is abscess in the neck region, and you, since the spinal accessory nerve is located very superficially, so if you are doing abscess drainage in case of injury, in case of the surgery, you can do the injury to the spinal accessory nerve, since it is located very superficially. So in iatrogenic injury, which we have induced it while draining the abscess, or an other procedure, we can damage the spinal accessory nerve. And since you can damage the spinal accessory nerve, the frequently asked question is that which of the following muscle is paralyzed, or what are the clinical signs and symptoms which we see. Since this nerve, the spinal accessory nerve, is damaged, so the distal area will not work properly. So since it is damaged from here, so sternocleidomastoid muscle will perform nicely, but trapezius muscle won't be performing. So there is a paralysis of the trapezius muscle and the person will not be able to shrug the shoulder. So if you know that the shrugging, which is exercise in case of when we do the workout weightlifting training, we do the shrugging. So shrugging is basically, sometimes we do the shrugging of the shoulder. So since there is injury to the spinal accessory nerve, which is located superficially, in case if we are draining the abscess in the neck, and there may be chances that we may damage the spinal accessory nerve, and then the trapezius get paralyzed. So that is a frequently asked question in MCQs. So spinal accessory nerve, 11th cranial nerve, is a component of the posterior triangle, or basically the occipital triangle of the neck. So out of the occipital triangle and the subclavian triangle, which are a component or a part of a posterior triangle of the neck, the occipital triangle is the biggest one. We know that brachial plexus trunk also passes from this, the cervical plexus, I must say, which is present at the middle of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So when we are giving the nerve block, we see that the cervical plexus is present, which has got various divisions like greater auricular nerve, lesser occipital nerve. We also have the transverse nerve of the neck. We have also supraclavicular nerve. But there is one nerve which we cannot block at all. That is the phrenic nerve, which is going to supply the diaphragms. If we block this phrenic nerve, then there is going to be paralysis of the diaphragm. The patient won't be able to breathe properly. There can be respiratory distress. So whenever you are giving this cervical plexus nerve block, you have to make sure that you are not blocking the phrenic nerve, because it is supplying the diaphragms. So you have to be very careful with the phrenic nerve. So we have 11th cranial nerve, that is the spinal accessory nerve in the occipital triangle. We also have the cervical plexus. In the occipital triangle, we also have the external jugular vein. And if you remember, internal jugular vein is a content of carotid sheath, is a content of carotid triangle. But the external jugular vein is a content of the posterior triangle of the neck, which is a content of the occipital triangle of the neck. So what are the contents of the posterior or the occipital triangle? We have the cervical plexus, we have the 11th cranial nerve, which is supplying the sternocleidomastoid, and the trapezius muscle, which is the spinal accessory nerve, which is situated very superficially. We also have the external jugular vein. The second triangle, posterior triangle, we have is the subclavian triangle. And why it is known subclavian triangle? Because we see the subclavian artery. So we see the subclavian artery in the subclavian triangle. So let's write the subclavian artery. So guys, we have studied the anterior triangles and the posterior triangle. In the anterior triangle, we have studied digastric triangle, submental triangle, which is present in the midline, the carotid triangle, the muscular triangle, which consists of the strap muscles, the muscles of the neck. We have also studied the posterior triangle. In the posterior triangle, we have studied the occipital triangle and the subclavian or the supraclavicular triangle. In the muscular triangle, there are anterior muscles of the neck like sternohyoid, basically the thyroid gland covered with the strap muscles. So these are all the anterior triangles. You can appreciate all the anterior triangles of the neck over here. So let's revise the content again. So as you can see, all the four anterior triangles, you can see nicely over here. You can appreciate all the four triangles, anterior triangles. So this is a digastric triangle. We have the submental triangle, so the carotid triangle, and the muscular triangle. So you can see all the four triangles over here. So guys, let's draw the diagrams with a diagrammatic representation. So we have anterior belly of digastric from the higher bone, so from the base of the mandible to the higher bone. So this is going to be anterior belly of digastric. Then we have the posterior belly of digastric as well. So up till the mastoid process. So this is our, again we'll draw from the other side also. On the other side we have the anterior belly of digastric. Then we also have the posterior belly of digastric inserting into the mastoid process. So this is our posterior belly of digastric. Then we also have the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So that originates from the sternum and the clavicle. Inserting into the mastoid process. Which marks the boundary between the anterior triangle of the neck and the posterior triangle of the neck. So this is our sternocleidomastoid. So that is our sternocleidomastoid. Which marks the boundary between the sternum and the clavicle.